I'm the editor of States of Play, Nordic LARP Around the World, which is the Solmukohta book of this year. You can see my name right there. And somebody asked me recently, Juhana, why did you do this book alone? Because I'm the only editor. But that is a gross misstatement. I would like maybe everybody here who had something to do with the book to just do this. Okay. And then I would like to have another clap, clap, clap for all of those. Woo! Yeah, because there's plenty of people involved with the book. The very first thing I would like to talk about is what I think personally is my greatest contribution to the tradition of the Solmukohta books. It is something that started in Denmark, like the book tradition itself, but which I'd like to think that I perfected. And that, of course, is the variant cover. Last year we had the white book version of Think LARP. This year we have three versions of the only book we have, because we are not the Danes. This is the version for people who come to Solmukohta. But in addition, we have the version for people who write for the book, and the version for people who didn't come to Solmukohta and desperately want to buy the book later or lend it from a library. I think that anything really beyond this is just an extra. I think in 4 years in Finland we will have tinfoil covers and all that other mid-90s Marvel comic stuff. Or maybe the Danes will do that in spite of us. There is another huge breakthrough in the covers. If you look at them carefully, you will notice it. It's here. I will help you with this. There is one thing missing here, which you will notice if you think a little bit. This here is a doll's face, another doll's face, the back of a human head, a human head covered with a mask, a painting of a human face. But this year, for the first time in history, we have a photo of a human face. Woo! Or three photos. Anyway. There's something about maybe 60 people involved in total with the production of this book. And I think I learned from watching the Oscar gala on TV that I will sadly not thank everybody personally. You can hate on me later for it. But there's a couple of people I would like to thank. Mostly the people I work with when in the production of this book. When I make stuff, it looks like the kind of text you have in a Word document. It's words, but it's not really visually very appealing. And that's why we have Tommi Kovala, who is sitting right here, who is responsible for the visual style of this book. Everything nice, when people say, it looks really good, you are not complimenting me, you are complimenting Tommi. Another new thing in this year's book is the DVD, which contains a LARP documentation. And I think he is not here today, but I will still say thank you. Because I was thinking, who can do the DVD for me? I cannot do a DVD. Who can take care of it? I was sitting at work. I produce a video game TV show. And I was sitting at my workplace thinking, who? And my gaze sort of settled on the man who was on the other side of the table from me at that moment, who was the editor of my TV show, and I asked him, can you do something for me? He's not a LARPer, so his contribution is especially, I think, nice. And then there's a third person I would like to thank, because I think I like to... Editing is nice. Thinking about variant covers is nice. I like it. Going through all of these is nice. But the thing I don't personally like is money, dealing with money. And the third person who, well, it's the fourth person, third person. Anyway, in our thing is, I think right there, Olga, who does all of our money stuff. So. The book is divided into four sections. I think you will notice that almost every idea here is from somewhere else, like for example from mid-90s Marvel comics. But this idea is actually from Nordic LARP, the book Nordic LARP, and the Danish book, what do LARP. Because I also believe strongly in LARP documentation. I was reading Beyond Role and Play recently, and in that book there is an article about the LARP panopticon. A nice article, interesting analysis. The one tiny detail missing from that article is that what is this LARP exactly? And in a few years, I think that information will be really hard to find. So and that's why it would have been nice if I had made in 2004 this kind of articles documentation, but. We didn't, we have to do it now. And that's why I stole the format from Nordic LARP and Do LARP to this book, and we have documentation articles. This fine photo is from Aaron Vanek's game Steeds. The idea is that you have two players for sort of every character, kind of, you have to read the article, where one of them has this fine-looking uniform, that's a camera, this is a blindfold, this is a helmet for style, and the other person, and he has a speaker in his ear. And the other person has a laptop and a microphone. And the laptop has a picture from this camera. And the person can, and then they are together try to navigate this environment. The other guy, no, there's a wall in front of you, turn 90 degrees to the ref, and so on. One of the, I think, more surprising games documented in this book. I can safely say that this is not an idea I could have come up with. And I think that holds true probably for everybody. There's a surprisingly large amount of Finnish games documented in this book. I'm very happy about that because for a long time I felt that we, here in Finland, we make great articles about role-playing, but our games are a little bit behind, but that is no longer true. One of the things which is nice in making a book like this, or role-playing journalism, or any kind of writing about other people's stuff, is that you always learn new, very surprising things. For example, I was surprised by this. And one of the things I was very surprised by was all of the Finnish people who make games, who I had never heard of before, who sort of appeared when I started making this book, because I had this assumption that I know what's going on in Finland. Turns out I didn't know anything. But now I know more. And you also, because you can read it in the book. By the way, if somebody has something to say, you can raise your hand or start yelling like crazy or do something like that. And we can. Yeah. Anyway, the next category is art and design. I'm going to make a slight point of criticism to last year's Danish books. Wonderful books, three books, that's great, I love them. But the one thing I felt was missing from those books was the Nudepunkt article, which I see as the art and design essay. There was no space for that article in those books. And that was something I very much wanted to fix in my book, because those are often my favorite articles. The articles about how to make role-playing games, how to make LARPs, new interesting ideas about what this all means, all kinds of stuff related to what role-playing, what LARP really is. And in a sense, this is a sort of a grab bag category of what I think is really the basic Nudepunkt article. This photo is from Johanna McDonald's game Tower Room, part of Johanna McDonald and Arni. Yes, Korpela's Walkabout series. And they have a very nice sort of a double act in the book where both of them wrote about their artistic project. And I don't know if they are here today, but I'm going to say it anyway. you can really see the point of having two articles when you read them, because they are completely different, amazingly different. But it's one of the nice things we have here. Another article I would suggest everybody to read. Wait a minute, that was another category. I will go to another category. Yes, New Frontiers. Another article I would suggest everybody to read is from, I'm going to embarrass myself, Mikael Mokoki, something like that. What was that? Mochoki. Let's take it at that. Reliving Sarmatia. Because in my experience, when we look at the Nordic LARP tradition, we have an aesthetic tradition. We have a bunch of great games, we have a toolbox of methods we use, and we have a set of political ideas which are more or less uncontroversial. One of the things I notice is that there is this idea that the tools and the ideology are somehow connected. That the tools themselves, the LARPs we make, are somehow inherently revolutionary or inherently good, or inherently further these specific goals which are our values and the things we want to make. But in this article, Reliving Sarmatia, you can see a completely another kind of a political vision, also built, created and taken further using exactly these same tools that have been developed in the Nordic LARP community. And I think reading that is a healthy thing to do for anybody who believes in the nobility of the tools themselves. I think for me personally, I learned from that article that the tools are neutral. It's a question of what you do with them that really makes the case. A personal favorite among the articles, of course, I love them all, but one of my favorites is Lizzie Stark's article, from which this photo is. Actually, it's from a game called Night Realms, but it's discussed in the article. The article is about the idea that that the American dream and the level progression in Dungeons and Dragons are like this. They are the same thing. I didn't understand it before I read it. When I read it, it was the most obvious thing in the world. And I think that's really one of the best things you can do in a book like this. When I was reading Beyond Role and Play and As LARP Grows Up and other previous Nude books, because I wanted to see what has been done before, I wanted to think about it as the editor, I noticed that sometimes I was reading and I was thinking, this stuff is so primitive, these people don't know anything. And then I remembered I was one of those people. I've read all of those books, but somehow it is not as obvious then than it is now. And one of the things that Lizzie does in this article is says something which is obvious now that it's said, but it's or will be obvious once you read it, but what was not obvious before. And I think that's something that has been done in every Nude book that's been published so far, and it's one of the things that really takes all of this forward. The New Frontiers category is supposed to be about stuff which is sort of new and exotic. Of course, the question is new from whose perspective? More or less my perspective. Or maybe I think most of yours perspective, but new from the Nordic perspective. So basically, if you have an article about something that's done in Poland, it goes into the New Frontiers category, even if for the Polish it's completely normal. And that is the case. Some of the stuff in this category I think is interesting in the sense that there's a lot of Nordic LARP pride going on. We are the best, everybody else sucks, our games are absolutely superior. But one of the things you notice when you have a dialogue with LARP cultures from around the world is that there's a lot of interesting stuff going on that actually is not done by us, amazingly enough. We can have a little bit of silence, you can cope with this idea. One of those articles was, for me, was Alexei Fedosev's article about songs on LARP. I don't know if you know what's the most important thing you must do in a LARP debriefing. I didn't know, embarrassingly enough. Klaus knows, because he's absolutely... The most important thing to do in a LARP debriefing is to have a group singing session. Did you know this? I didn't know this until I read the article. But actually it makes plenty of sense. And that's the wonderful thing about Alexei's article is that, like with Lizzie, the stuff seems very exotic when you start to read it, but then when he describes all the methods you can do when you take a LARP and use song as a method in the game, it starts to make sense. You start to think, actually, this is really cool. All of these tools are wonderful. Why don't we sing all of our games? There must be more singing games. His argument for the debriefing is that when you have a large group singing session, it brings people together on an emotional level, which is very important when you have had an emotionally divisive experience like a LARP, and it creates kind of a common healing moment. I think that's absolutely true. The fourth category, I put myself here because I'm vain. The fourth category, it's good game, bad game. There are supposed to be five categories. There was a category for great positive LARP experiences and horrible catastrophes. But unfortunately, apparently people don't have enough great LARP experiences or horrible catastrophes, so I had to put them in one category. And I've written two articles myself to make it big enough. But I hope you can survive it. Anyway, this is actually maybe sort of my favorite category, the mistakes, I mean my favorite category, because that's also an idea stolen from the Danes. There was the discussion in last year's Nudebunkt where people like Erland and Eric Fatland went and explained the horrible mistakes from games they had made. And I found that to be both educational and extremely funny. I thought it was surprisingly interesting to see the kind of mistakes people make. And I wanted to replicate that also in this book. Due to the apparent lack of mistakes, I don't know if I was super successful, but I hope that the others will continue this proud work after me. Then the positive stuff, I thought that one of the things which is hard to understand when you read all of these books, for example, is why people play role-playing games, why people play LARP. What is it? What's the great thing about it? You learn a lot of little things about how they are made and why they are interesting and blah 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 blah. But what you don't learn is what is the sort of positive emotional core of a good experience. And that's what I tried to capture with the positive short articles. I wrote one of them those myself. For me, of course, this positive core of what role-playing can truly be is kidnapping, as we can see in this photo. Out of the photo, here is the guy I'm beating with the stick. Because I discovered that in the game Valve, an excellent campaign, I discovered that that kidnapping people is really fun. And I would like to think that that's something people don't learn in anywhere else except in LARP. Maybe some people learn, but I hope maybe none of them are here. Anyway, and for me that was one of the sort of joyous role-playing moments. I felt that my life has become richer because I have kidnapped. I really recommend it for everybody. Okay. Then we have the DVD, as I already mentioned. We have a little bit kind of a grab bag of video stuff from different games which are documented or mentioned in the articles in the book. One of them is Danish, Kapo. All the rest are from Finland. This was kind of an accident, but that is the situation anyway. One person I also would like to thank is the editor of Kapo, Edith, who is editor of the person who made the Kapo movie, half an hour movie about Kapo, Edith, who is not here today because she's in Denmark, but I know she worked around the clock to make it to the book because I was also with her in Skype saying, "Where is the documentary?" And she was talking back to me. Anyway, also this is something I would like to see more of, collections of video material from games, edited collections of short documentaries about games where you can see what's going on. I think this idea of collecting all of that stuff in one place is still kind of at the start, and I hope that other people will do something brilliant with it later. Anyway, this is that's the title of the second title of the book, Nordic Love Around the World. That's a book of picture of Mike in 2000. 2000 Solmukohta was my first nudepunkt. I met like Swedes and Norwegians, and I was amazed by this. Mike published his manifesto, which was ridiculed at the time. Later on, it became the sort of accepted wisdom, but at that point, it was ridiculed and also burned. One of the things I noticed only very late about this period photo is that that's snow. This is also snow, and that's a T-shirt. I looked at this photo like 20 times before I realized that there's something strange about this. The shoulder here belongs to Jock. Anyway, what I noticed when I was looking at all of that old stuff is how far we're gone and how much the Solmukohta scene and the Nordic LARP itself has changed. Because at that point, what we were looking at, we were in a situation where I, as somebody from Finland, meet somebody from Sweden, and then we can have some cultural exchange. We can exchange ideas. Our games can become, the Swedes are doing this, we must do this also. But then at some point, all of these things start to fuse, come together, and we have the idea of a nudepunkt game, a game specifically for this crowd. Some kind of a synthesis of all these styles. And at some point, it stopped being about cultural exchange between the Nordic countries, I think, because everything that should be exchanged was already exchanged, I think. And it became kind of a unified style for making ambitious, interesting, artistically relevant games about serious subjects, about political subjects, formally experimental, all this kind of stuff. Because there was an audience for it, there was a tradition for it, and there was the great Solmukohta event where we could brag about it, the book where you could write about it, there was a kind of an infrastructure for doing this. But at the same time, it stopped being about exchange and it started to be maybe about cooperation. And this has some interesting implications for where we are now. Right now we are in a situation where we have the Nordic LARP. What is Nordic LARP? I think Nordic LARP is an artistic movement for creating a specific kind of LARP, kind of an idea about what LARP can be. And what that means is that you can make a Nordic LARP in Italy, as apparently is being done. You can make Nordic LARP in the US, and you can have the bizarre idea of having a cultural exchange between Nordic LARP and Finnish LARP, as I think is happening, for example, at this event. You have people who make LARPs in Finland, who hear about Solmukohta, who come here, maybe are in here right now, and want to learn about some of these ideas. And all of this means that the idea of Nordic LARP has become kind of a free-floating thing. Something that is no longer about, I don't know, being Nordic, or any of these historical things where it came from. Personally, I think this is a wonderful thing. I like to see all of these ideas going out to the world. I like to see the ideas that come back to us and the new synthesis of what can be done. I've heard sometimes people say these kind of things that Solmukohta, how can we go on? It's not like it was before, and that's absolutely true. And it will never be. It's always transforming into some kind of a new thing, a new beautiful, wonderful thing. And that's what the title is about. Nordic LARP here and also in other parts of the world. So that's the last slide. If you want to download the PDF, you can do it in this address. That's the address of our publishing house. This photo is also from the book. It's from Lauri Lukka's article about multi-generational role-play games. Because as you know, most people have only known this kind of a primitive kind of role-playing game where you play only one character instead of the modern kind of role-playing game where you play a lineage of people descended from each other. Lauri makes a convincing case in his article about why this kind of role-playing is absolutely the best. And his case is, I think, really made with the photos, one of which is here. Because I would like to think that this is the kind of playing I want to play. Okay, does something have something to say? No, I see hands like...